Welcome to DigitalOcean Deploy. My name is Paul Stack, Stack72 on Twitter. And my talk today is a talk called Infrastructure as Software. So we all understand that there's a lot of change of companies moving to the cloud right now and trying to get the system that they've developed correct to work in the cloud. There are a number of variations in how people actually deploy their systems into the cloud. And, you know, we can look at these. So we have a V1 style system, and that's effectively they've picked up their entire data center. They've moved it to the cloud in its current state, and you usually have an N-tier style architecture. So you have web servers, you have application servers. They're more than likely long-lived. So because they're long-lived, they're probably using something like a configuration management tool, maybe Puppet, Chef, SaltStack, Ansible, one of these different things. And it tends to be a little more static in how you actually move. It's like traditionally, you know, you don't tend to use anything in the specific cloud itself, but you're understanding that there are a lot of different pieces of the cloud, but you're just not maybe ready to use them right now. Then you have people who have gone a little further, a little more beyond that, and they have a much more transitional style architecture. So when I say a transitional style architecture, I mean like, you know, they're starting to take advantage of maybe a mixture of containers and VMs, probably using like Docker or, you know, a hosted service in the specific cloud that's there. They could be bringing in like a hosted database or using their own database, and they definitely are be taking advantage of like a monitoring SaaS style tool to understand how their systems are working in production. And then you have people who have gone even further beyond that. And this is what's starting to be called like modern style infrastructures in the cloud. You've probably heard terms like cloud native or microservices or all these different things. And this is like a combo. This style architecture, this V3 architecture, is comprised of a lot of these different terms. So you're probably taking advantage of, definitely taking advantage of some compute style services. You're possibly taking advantage of some serverless, so some functions or some Lambda or something like that, depending on the cloud that you're working in. And then more than likely, you're taking advantage of a container hypervisor. So something that's actually orchestrating all of the different pieces that's going on in there right now. And it's at this point in time, it's quite popular and fashionable to use Kubernetes or HashiCorp Nomad or something like that. And then, of course, you could be taking advantage of other systems as well, like machine learning or big data or any of these different things in order to help you actually understand what's going on in your system and actually build more sophistication and connected services between what's going on in here. So traditionally, there are three ways of managing the cloud. We have people, and it's not, you know, it's okay to say that they're still doing it today. We have people who are still using the web console to provision services in the cloud. It's not the most beneficial way of building things. It's kind of hard to scale. It's difficult for users and resources. And of course, it's, you know, it's not really repeatable and moving stuff or repeatable in how you actually are building things. And you have other teams who are gone past the web console stage. They're probably using like CLI tools, scripts, templates, some things that are actually starting to move towards what we would class as infrastructure as code, which is much more automatable. You know, it can be versioned correctly in source control. It's reusable. It's probably idempotent. But trying to roll things out is a little more difficult because, you know, it's your own scripts around different things. You need to understand changes in the upstream APIs, changes in the system that's going on, and it becomes a wee bit more difficult to understand what's happening in here. And then you definitely have a lot of people in this era of the engineering who are starting to use code, and you're actually starting to take advantage of writing your infrastructure in terms of how you would write application code. So versioning and testing, all these different things is going through. And this is and different teams can have a variation of different ways, even within the same team. But these are the main ways of automating the cloud. Now, moving to the cloud is difficult. Automation, adoption of the cloud is tough because we have a lot of teams who are built of legacy sort of IT organizations and they still have a lot of silos in their organization. So we have like developers and operators working on completely different systems. You have teams that have worked on a cloud in one environment and a different cloud in the new environment. And then, you know, it's difficult and it's error prone for the tools that it's difficult for them to get started with. And then as the current situation, this era of COVID has made things even more difficult because we have to increase the speed of our adoption or movement to the cloud much faster. It's actually even tougher to get started in there because the multitude of services available right now actually means it's very difficult for people to understand how to get their system to run in the cloud. It's not cloud native by default. It's probably a brownfield application, an old application, and it's slower and more difficult for people to actually push it into the cloud. So this is where cloud engineering is starting to come in. This is a new term that's starting to appear and start to be understood by a lot of different people. And it's much because DevOps has transformed a lot of IT organizations. So, you know, used to have centralized ops teams, but of course they're passing the power back now to security teams, to application teams. We even have infrastructure teams, SRE teams. We have all these different people managing different parts of the system. And it used to be, and that's, I'm sorry to have to say this, that operations teams used to be the gatekeepers to the system. And they used to be the people that said, no, you cannot release that, or it's not fit for purpose. But it's now that the operations team are the enabler for the system. So they're actually a lot of the teams that are driving the change, driving the transformation, and driving what's happening in the system. So it's, things are changing as we go through, and it's very interesting to see how this is actually working. Now, of course, that means that there are different ways of building things. Now we're starting to build modern architectures. So this is where we class cloud native. It's, you know, it's more greenfield applications. It's split out. It's more microservice based. And it's taking advantage of VMs, containers, and serverless. You know, that sort of empowers these high modern teams, which actually are able to continuously deliver systems into the cloud, of course, in a safe way in combination with the operations team and the security team. And of course, if we can get this right, we're able to be in this multi-cloud scenario that a lot of people dream is the nirvana, where we have private public hybrids, even across different cloud vendors with built-in security and all these different things. So it's a very much a changing ecosystem. And not only is it a changing ecosystem, the goalposts are continually moving on the tooling and everything that's there. So just a very quick recap, what infrastructure as code is. Now, infrastructure as code is bringing the best practices to our infrastructure management. It's providing a way to collaborate on infrastructure changes, and we track our changes from code commits and source code the whole way through to deployment. It's important because it replaces manual error-prone processes with automation. And that's, of course, the goal. That's the key of what we're actually trying to do. It's faster to get our code into production. Because it's automated, we have pipelines and we can actually test things as it's going through. And the most important thing about infrastructure as code is it brings safety and predictability to our infrastructure because we're able to see and plan in advance what it's going to do. And because it's idempotent, we will understand that it's not just going to break things every single time. Now, Pulumi is a new modern infrastructure as code tool. That allows us to start bringing programming languages or modern familiar languages that developers and operations teams use into their workflow for the cloud. And it works with any cloud. We have a lot of providers. It's open source and it's free, of course, but it has a commercial SaaS aspect to it as well. Now, it's very important to talk about a few things for Pulumi first. One, it is declarative by default. So what you specify in your application is actually what will be deployed. But how it gets there is through imperative applications. Now, you, even though we said that it uses programming languages, you do not need to use any programming constructs by default. You will actually just use declarative syntax and you will learn a Pulumi SDK for a specific cloud. But when you start to be able to get more complexity in your system, you can then start to refactor your code. You can use conditionals and for loops and programming constructs and what's happening. You have the ability that you can create multi-provider workflows so that you can have the outputs of some resources as the inputs of others because Pulumi works in the idea of promises and it will resolve those promises at runtime. And because of that, we're actually able to mix and match different deployments. In this example, you're storing some data in a storage bucket and you're using that data to be passed into a Kubernetes deployment. We very much build on top of the language ecosystem. So that means that we can actually package our infrastructure and code our infrastructure using things like PyPy, NuGet, NPM, and be able to create those specific packages and share those around our colleagues and our teams. And then some of the more interesting things about Pulumi is that it actually enables this advanced orchestration, this advanced strategies that we were really hoping. So what we would usually do for Canary Deploy is that we would deploy a couple of instances of our application. We would then go to our monitor, our metrics tool, and then we would come back to our application and we would continue the run, the system of how it's actually going. But with Pulumi, it actually can talk to any API or any SDK that is currently in the code that you're writing. And in this case, we can see that we deploy three replicas of our application. We then go off and we check Prometheus. When everything is okay with Prometheus, we continue with the next sort of 10 replicas of our application. And we can layer that through our workflow as we actually need to go. Now, I said that Pulumi was starting to be able to move us towards infrastructure as software because of the fact that it's modern infrastructure as code with a need to back up real teams and how real software works. And one of the ways that we're actually able to do that is by introducing test-driven infrastructure into our test-driven development into our infrastructure development. Now, we have given you different ways that you can adopt the testing pyramid. So unit testing, integration test, and runtime testing all can actually embed as part of your CI/CD workflow, as you will see very shortly in my demo. And of course, because of that, we can actually start to really test the code that we're writing, not just hope that when we deploy the applications, it'll work as expected, and we will have to then debug as we need to go through. One of the things that's important here to say is when I say test-driven, I actually do mean we can be test-driven because we can mock the cloud, we can mock the requests and the responses coming back from the cloud vendor, which means we can actually black box develop our code, and then when we're actually confident that we're ready to start testing it, we can then bring up our infrastructure and test it as we need to, rather than spending lots of time and money on iterating within a specific cloud itself. And then probably my favorite thing about Pulumi is that we try and embed security practices as part of what we're actually trying to do. So for me, it's, you know, testing is one thing, development is another thing, but security is a huge thing right now that we're not very good at it in this industry. We're trying to get better at it. So we try and give that same sort of experience that security is important right from the outset, the same way as testability and CI/CD is. So we give you ways in which you can actually implement security management of your secrets and your configuration as part of your Pulumi pipeline. Now, of course, we can book, you can use the Pulumi SaaS to do this, or you can actually use systems like HashiCorp Vault, AWS KMS, GCP KMS, or Azure Key Vault in order to do this. So as more and more security tools come out, we'll integrate with more tools in order to make like each team's scenarios work here. So let's go and actually have a demo of what we're going to do. And in this demo, we're actually going to look at the testability of what's actually going on in here. Now, as you can see from the results of the demo, that the CI/CD workflow is actually embedded the whole way through the Pulumi infrastructure testing application that I showed you. So we can see that straight away we do a Yarn install. So this is a TypeScript application, as I told you, and that will allow us to install the latest dependencies. Now, of course, if you need it to be against a local dependency, you can include that as part of what you're doing. But, you know, we actually have a Yarn install, which will go off and NPM install all the different things. Now, as part after that, we then do a Pulumi stack init. We run a Pulumi preview to make sure that everything looks like it's going to be okay. Then we run a Pulumi up. Now, of course, here we have to run it in a non-interactive mode because we don't want to wait for anyone to have to click anything on the terminal. But we're in a situation right now where we have an application that's actually being brought up. Once we have the application up, we just perform some extra tasks. Okay, we export the stack, we re-import it to make sure that the integrity of the stack is there. Then we run a preview after we import it and another Pulumi up to make sure everything works as expected. And then what we actually do is we perform that extra runtime validation that we actually encoded as part of our test. So here we're actually going off to the endpoint of our load balancer that we created in DigitalOcean. And we're actually testing that the endpoint actually brings back the correct HTTP request, which as we saw is welcome to Nginx. And once we're happy with that, then we can destroy our application and we can remove our stack. So, you know, this is the entire workflow encoded in our application acceptance test. And that way we can continually run the same workflow that we would do in our CI/CD pipeline as part of our testing and pull requests. So we're trying to bring that system into actually what we're doing here. So we actually believe that as we start to move towards this modern infrastructure as cloud, that Pulumi is the going to be the easiest way for a lot of teams to actually get that going, because we have thought about what different teams need to do as they go forward. We thought about the testability, the security, the CI/CD pipeline, the reusability, the versioning, the packaging, because we believe that this is actually what a lot of teams are actually going to need to do, what a lot of teams want to do, and what a lot of teams have to move towards in the future as they start to make their cloud journey faster and their velocity to deploy their applications in the cloud much faster. So I'm going to say thank you so much for your time today. I am going to say enjoy the rest of your conference. And if you need any further information about anything I've showed you today, you can get in contact with me, paul@pulumi.com, or you can tweet me at stack72. I'm always on Twitter. I'm always available. And thank you so much for having me.